So I'm going to get rid of all this evidence. You guys, if you have more questions about the course or about me or anything, you can, you can ask me some point. But this course, Calculus 2, starts with this chapter 6, and the chapter 6 is called Differential Equations. What's kind of funny about that is there's a whole course called Differential Equations. Oops, what the heck? Sorry about that. Differential Equations. Hey, there's a whole course called Differential Equations. Actually, there's more than, there's Differential Equations 1, and there's Advanced Differential Equations, and there's Partial Differential Equations. That's another course. And Advanced Partial Differential Equations. And I mean, this is all kind of up at the junior, senior university level. This is a whole big, broad topic. Okay, so we're spending 2 weeks on differential equations, okay? So we're getting a little taste of differential equations and take a little test on it. And you've seen it a little bit before in a Cal 1 class, perhaps. You might have seen a question like this. Well, first of all, a differential equation is an equation that has a derivative in it. How about that? It's an equation that has a derivative in it. So watch this. Here's an equation with a derivative in it. Y prime equals 6x squared plus 3x. So this is an equation with a derivative in it. And when we say we want to solve this equation or solve the differential equation, here's what that means. Solve the DE. By the way, look, I'm going to abbreviate it as DE, differential equation. To solve the DE means this. Find the function y that, I'm going to say, satisfies the DE. Listen, I'm just going to regress for a second, but back to good old algebra. When someone tells you this, they say, solve the equation. You know, what are you doing? You're solving for x. That's different than what I just said, actually, but this is old algebra. You solve for x. What you're looking for is the x that makes this true. Or satisfies this equation is one way to say that. Or it makes the equation true. You're looking for the x, right? You're looking for the x that makes this true. Well, we're looking for the function y that makes this true. So, and what I have is y prime, but the answer to a DE is y, some function y. So, now listen, you're smart Calculus 1 students, or you were. Now you're Calculus 2 students. But anyway, if you got y prime, how do you get y? Good. You integrate. You find the antiderivative is another way to say that. If you've got y prime and you're trying to get y, you do the opposite of differentiating. You integrate. So I simply integrate to get y. Now, let me show you some proper cool notation, though, here, okay? Watch this notation here. So y prime is called the derivative of y. It's y prime. Look, another way to write this derivative is dy dx. Do you remember that? It doesn't mean anything different. It's just a different notation for the derivative. Y prime is the derivative of y. Dy dx is the derivative of y with respect to x. Okay, now watch this move. This is a funny move. I'm going to take this dx and sort of multiply it up here to this side. You know, it's sort of an algebraic move. I'm sort of multiplying both sides by dx, is one way to say it. On this side, when you multiply by dx, it cancels. On this side, when you multiply by dx, it shows up here. You know, it's algebra. And then I end up with this. So I'm solving this differential equation, and I am going to integrate, but I'm sort of, these first two moves are kind of good, okay? They're real good, actually, to help explain a few things. So now I'm here, I'm still trying to find the function y that satisfies the DE. I think I'm gonna do this move now. Integrate both sides. I mean, a few seconds ago, y'all said, let's integrate or do an antiderivative, but I just did this notational moves here. Now you're right, I do wanna integrate both sides of this equation. So I integrate this side of the equation. Now notice something, you're integrating a one with respect to y. Do you know what the answer is? Good, y. Right, the answer is y. And she was saying I should put a plus c. You know, she's kind of right. I'll put a plus c there. Okay, I'm sorry. I'm back. Sometimes I talk too fast. Okay, the step here was integrate both sides. So I should have put an integral here and an integral here. Okay. And then I integrated this side and got y plus c. Let's integrate the other side. You know about your power rules, I hope, and you know, this was chapter 5, you learned how to integrate. It's the opposite of differentiating. You add 1 to that, x cubed, divide by 3, so 2x cubed, plus, and then you add 1, x squared, divide by 2, 3 halves, x squared, plus c, plus another c. Hang on. Yeah, so when you got this other C, you don't really want to, it's not the same C. Yeah, it's not the same C. In fact, maybe I should put a little subscript called this guy C1, and now this guy's C2. What?
Couldn't you just subtract the C1 from the C2, and then you just get C?
Right.
Thank you. Hey, thank you. That's what I was going to do next. I was going to ask you, this is kind of stupid with all these C's here. Right. He's right. Couldn't you just kind of, this is an arbitrary constant. Can't you subtract it or add it to this other arbitrary constant and call it?
C.
An arbitrary constant called C. Yeah, of course. Mm-hmm. So cool. The official answer then is this. In other words, lump him together and I'm lumping those arbitrary C's together and I get 2x cubed plus 3 halves x squared, just put plus C. You guys all right? Mm-hmm. And so the truth is, in the future, because of that, hopefully you understood that last little move, dumping the C's together, they're arbitrary C's anyway, just call it one constant. You don't need two constants, right? And in the future, when I do this problem, you know what, I won't even, when I integrate this side, I won't even put this C. I mean, why? I don't really need to put this if I'm going to lump it in with this other C anyway. You follow me?
Yeah.
Okay, I did it on this first one. I ended up, you know, this first one, we were thinking our way through this. But in the future, I don't need this plus C one. But I do need a plus C. When you're doing differential equations, forgetting about the plus C altogether is pretty bad. But we found this, we found the answer, and I want to say that this answer is called a general solution. And all we did was integrate. You guys, it was easy. I mean, we integrated, but I am talking the language of chapter 6, which is sort of new to you, which is multiply the dx to the other side, integrate both sides. You know, this is the process. And when I get done, I have what's called a general solution to the differential equation. Okay, watch this. A general solution, what if somebody said graph this? What's funny is, how do you graph something with a plus C on it? Well, you sort of pretend what you do is you graph a bunch of things for a bunch of different C's. Like what you do is for a second, pretend C is 0. Now, I'm not going to do a great official graph here, but I know this is a cubic function. So if you don't mind, I don't know. Maybe it looks like that. It's a cubic function. Maybe I want a better. Anybody want to pick up their graphing calculator and tell me what that looks like? Trying to make a point, I don't really care, but my graph is roughly okay, but let's just not be rough, let's be a little more accurate. Can you pick up a graphing calculator and show me it is a cubic function? what am I saying? If C is zero, what does he look like? If C is a zero, can you please help me? I mean, I bet I was close, but. Yeah, I was close.
If you zoom in close right there, is there a little?
Is there an extra little? I think there might be an extra little x-intercept right there. Oh, that's what it's doing. It's really zoomed in. Yeah, yeah, that's better. Yeah, that's kind of, see what I'm saying? It's kind of like that, technically. Whatever. What did I just graph? I graphed this function with C equal to zero. Okay, guess what? What if C is one, you guys? What happens when C is one? What? It moves up one. What if C is two? It moves up two. What if C is 17? It moves up 17. So really what you have, when you have this general solution with an arbitrary C, you sort of have a whole family of functions for various values of C. So watch this. When you just move them up, then they just kind of, look, here they are. A whole family. Some of them might be moved down. I'm sorry, I'm getting sloppy. But it's a whole family of functions is what a general solution is. You okay? Solve the DE. Find a general solution. It's got a plus C in it. A general solution with a plus C in it is a whole family of functions. Okay, now watch this. Same problem. Same problem, but we're gonna at the beginning of this problem, we're gonna say solve this DE subject to, look, now I'm changing the beginning of this problem, I'm gonna add something called an initial condition. It's called an initial condition. It also could be called an initial value. And here it is, you could say it like this, when x is 1, y is 4. Another way to say it, that's the initial condition I'm giving you. The other way to say it is y of 1 equals 4. That's kind of funny, but you know what I just did? It's like I'm calling the function y, that's like I'm calling it y of x. Instead of f of x, I'm calling it y of x. So y of 1 equals 4. So that's an initial condition. Guess what? If you have an initial condition, you don't stop with a general solution. You know what you do? You plug in that x and y at the end, not at the beginning, but at the end, you plug in that x and y, and if you do plug in that x and y, guess what you'll find?
C.
You'll find C. And then if you find C, you won't have a general solution anymore. You'll have a particular solution. You'll have, remember I called this a family of solutions?
Right.
See, now we're looking for the one member of the family that goes through that point. See, now the question is a little different. I'm looking for the one member of the family that satisfies this initial condition or has this initial value that when x is 1, y is 4. Let me just see. When x is a 1, y is a 4. I don't know. I'm not sure who that is, but it's one of these members of this family. Are you following me?
Mm-hmm.
And it's called a particular solution. It's looks terrible there. 1, 4. When x is 1, y is 4. So now how do you start this problem? Oh, you do everything the same. You get here, and now you got one little bit of added work. Plug in the initial condition and find C. Here we go. Y is a 4, X is a 1. It's kind of stupid to write 1 cubed and 1 squared, I know. To spell things out a little bit. That is just a 1, no? This is 2 plus 3 halves plus C. That's 1 and a half. It's 3 and a half, isn't it? When you subtract it, this is a half, I think.
Mm-hmm.
I did a lot of fancy algebra in my head there, but we just found C is a half. And don't just circle C as a half. Now you should plug the C back in, and now I want to write my answer. Y equals 2x cubed plus 3 halves x squared plus C. What's C? 1 half? and we call this a not, we don't, now we call this a particular solution. Particular solution. And it's not, no, it's no longer a family. It's one member of the family. It's one specific graph, one specific solution, particular solution. How you guys doing? You guys all right? That's a good little introduction to differential equations. I mean, that's differential equations. I didn't pick the hardest problem in the world. It was an easy problem. It was easy to integrate, right? Mm-hmm. But the language is here, okay? And I didn't use some of the language. I need to tell you something else here. But the method of solving, general solution, if you have an initial condition or initial value, you get a particular solution. The graph is either a family of graphs or one particular member of that family. So the language is new for chapter 6. Some of the language is new here. But the skills are, can you integrate? And kind of. Can you plug in some numbers? Let me show you a more advanced one, though, here. Look at this guy. Here's a classic. This is classic. Y prime equals 0.4y. That's a 0.4. Okay, I wonder if I should put an initial condition on this. Let me put an initial condition. Y of 0 equals 30. So it looks like I have a differential equation with an initial condition. You guys agree? Okay, so the question is, solve it. And actually it might say, find the general solution. But if there's an initial condition given, then please find a particular solution. No, that's what the directions might be. Anyway, this one does have an initial condition. So I want to solve this. Now, do you remember my first steps? What were my first steps?
Dy dx.
So you call this dy dx. I think that's important. You change it to dy dx instead of y prime. And then the only thing I did last time was I multiplied the dx over. But the truth is, on this problem, this is a little more advanced. This is a different problem. What I need to do on this problem is a method of solving called separation of variables. Separation of variables. I'm going to just rephrase it another way. I'm going to call it separate and integrate. Because I like to rhyme, you know? Rhyme. Separate and integrate. Probably write a nice song to that or something. Separate and integrate. See, by multiplying the dx to the other side, watch what you get. Dy equals 0.4y times dx. Now, if someone said, okay, now integrate. Now, hold on. So please don't. But if you're trying to integrate this, don't do it, please. What's weird is I'm trying to integrate y's with respect to x. See, this is bad. What I need is I need all the y's with the dy's, and I need all the x's with the dx. Now, in my last problem, it happened real easy. All I had was x's. I put the dx over there. Do you remember? But this time, in the last problem, the separate was real easy. In this problem, the separate takes a couple more steps. I need all the y's with the dy's. I need all the x's with the dx. So I got one more move I need to do here. Do you know what it would be? How do you get all the y's over here with the dy? Divide by y. Thank you. Divide by y. Divide by y. I'll leave the 0.4 over there. So here we go. Now we have dy over y equals 0.4 dx. That's it. That was the separate process. You separate the dy and the dx. You separate the dy and dx, but you also get all the y's with the y, dy, and all the x's with the dx. You guys with me? Are you with me? Do you have a question? So that's the separate part. Now you do the integrate part. Remember, in the last problem, integrating this side was real easy because all it was a dy, so when we integrated, all we got was y. This time, when we integrate, it's a 1 over y dy. How do you integrate a 1 over y dy?
Ln y.
Ln y. Right? Mm-hmm. That's the ln of y. On the other side, we're going to integrate with respect to x. So that's a 1 over y dy. It shouldn't be too big of a mystery. That is, when you integrate a 1 over y dy, it's the ln of y. The ln of y. Technically, there's absolute value on it. I'm going to integrate the other side. With respect to x, how do you integrate a 0.4 with respect to x?
0.4x.
Okay, is anybody forgetting anything?
Plus c.
Oh, yeah, plus c. Plus C is kind of a crucial part of the game. Cool. Cool, cool, cool. You know what? I should say something here. In a way, we've already solved the DE. But the problem is, I would call this an implicit general solution. Why do I call it implicit?
It's not y equals, it's a log of
4. Good. I call it implicit because it's not explicit. And what's explicit? When y is all by itself. Right. So we want to make it explicit. We want to solve for y. We want to get y by itself. So let's watch the, this is going to be cool. These next steps are cool. I want to solve for y.
Use raised to the power of e, right?
Right.
Good. So you E, to get rid of the natural log, you E both sides. Here, I'll write that here. I'm going to E the natural log of this, and on the other side, I'm going to E the whole side. I'm E-ing the whole side. This is important.
Oh.
This is important. I'm E-ing the whole side. It's funny how day one you get some cool, important stuff, you know?
Yeah.
It's good stuff. E the entire side. Listen, a bad algebra move if somebody says, oh, I'm going to E each term. You don't do each term. You do the whole side. You see how I did that?
Yeah.
All right, anyway, the point was the E and the log cancel each other out. And you're going to get Y. Technically, there's an absolute value on that Y. Listen, I'm about to lose it. I'm just going to write Y. I don't want the absolute value on there. Do you need an explanation? You're curious math students. Of course you need an explanation.
It's because that absolute value just goes away with the ln, right?
I don't know. I don't think that's a good explanation.
That
but mine might not be much better. I'm losing it. I'm losing the absolute value. Let me think here. What's the point?
It's almost false. This.
Oh, because when you E both sides, E to the anything is always positive.
Positive, yeah.
E to the anything is always positive. So there's no reason for this Y to have absolute value on it because it's going to equal something that's always positive. Yeah, maybe that's the good explanation of it. Good. We lose the absolute value of this move right here at this point. Cool. Watch this move. You guys know about when you... Watch this move. E to the 0.4x times e to the c. I'd like you to understand that move. I'd like you to understand it. I'd like you to show it to me when you have to do it on a test or a quiz. I'd like you to not do it incorrectly. I'd like you to do it correctly like that. What the heck did I just do? You know, if you're multiplying like bases, don't you add exponents?
Right.
So I'm doing that backwards. I had added exponents. And I separated it into multiplied bases. And now,
yes.
Since C is an arbitrary C, what's E to the C?
C.
Just C?
C. Yeah.
You know, this when C is funny, you know, C is an arbitrary constant. What if you have C and you add 2 to it? It's still C. What if you have a C and you multiply it by 3? It's C. So what if you have a C and you E it? We're just going to call it C. There's no variables in it. It's a constant. Mm-hmm. So that's a mul- that's a C. I'm going to write it in front, and this is the answer.
Yeah.
That's a C. This is this. There, I'm done. Oh, well, wait a minute. What did I just find?
That's the general.
I had this. This was an implicit general solution. I solved for Y, which took several steps, but I solved for Y, so now I would call this an explicit general solution. Is that okay?
Yeah.
I didn't use that word last problem, but this is an explicit general solution. But I did want, because it had an initial condition, an initial value, sometimes I forget about this thing, but it's there, I better apply it and find C. And then once I find C, I have a particular solution. Mm-hmm. It's easy, by the way. When you plug in a 0 for x, y is 30. When you plug in a 0 for x, y is 30. That's e to the 0. And so e to the 0 is 1. So c is 30. Cool. C is 30. And so here's my answer. 30 e to the 0.4x. Pretty cool, you guys. That's pretty cool, you guys. That's a classic differential equation. And in a way, it wasn't that hard. I'm a teacher. It takes me a while to explain every step. You know, it doesn't really take that long to do this problem, but it takes me a while to explain it all, especially day one. Yeah, that's good. This idea of separation of variables or separated integrals, it's a method for solving DEs. And the method is separate and integrate. See, we did it, okay? So I think they teach you this method up in 6.3. But what's kind of funny is, I mean, you can do it a little bit in 6.1 and 6.2. I mean, I wanted to teach it to you. You know, I didn't want to wait. So I kind of jumped ahead to 6.3, I guess. But this is how this class flows. Sometimes I like my lectures to flow logically and interesting and get to a point. It might not always jive exactly how the book works. In fact, the book opens with this boring stuff. You ready for this? Watch this. Let me show you something. Here comes exciting, boring stuff. You ready? Your book opens in 6.1 with questions kind of like this. They give you a differential equation. This is kind of a tough differential equation. It's got a y double prime. It's got a y prime. And anyway, I'm not going to solve this one. I'm not going to teach you how to solve this one until you take differential equations, the real course. All right. So we're not going to solve this one. But you know what they do to me at first here? They're getting me used to differential equations. So they say, hey, look at one. Hey, look at this guy. It's a differential equation. You can't solve it. In fact, here's what they do. Here's the solution. They're going to tell you the solution. The solution is C1 e to the negative 2x plus C2 e to the negative x. They say that that's the solution, that's the differential equation, and that's the general solution, and here's what they ask you to do. Please verify it. Verify. Now, verify that that's the solution. Now, verify or show or prove or... So what does that mean? That means if you took this function and plugged it in, it should work. Okay, but what do you need to plug in? You need the function to plug in right there. What are you going to plug in there? Oh, you need a derivative. What are you going to plug in there?
The
second derivative. Oh, okay. That's what you do on a problem like this. They give you the answer, and to verify that it really works, they want you to prove that it works. They want you to take a couple derivatives, plug them in, and watch it work. Really exciting. You seem like you're... I called it boring myself. By the way, it makes you practice doing some damn derivatives, which is good for you. Let's try this problem. So I want a derivative. You guys, do you know how to do derivatives of e functions? I got a constant multiplied by e to the negative 2x. I want to do a derivative now. I think the constant just sits there, and I take the derivative of e to the negative 2x. What's the derivative of e to the negative 2x?
Negative 2 e to the negative 2x.
Good. The derivative of e to the negative 2x is himself. The chain rule says you have to multiply by a negative 2. Right. I'm going to multiply by a negative 2, but I'm going to put it out front there. And I'm not going to absorb it into the C1. It's a little tempting, but please don't. And to verify this, we don't want to absorb the constants. We want to leave the constants kind of like they were originally. If I absorb the 2 into that constant, it's no longer C1, is it? Right, it's some new C3 or C, you with me? So I don't want to do that. I don't want to absorb that. Let's move over here. Take this guy's derivative. It's a C2. It's a constant. You take the derivative of an e function. The derivative of an e function is himself. The chain rule spits out the derivative of the negative x, which is a little
negative
1. That gets multiplied out front, if you don't mind. That's doing a derivative with a little chain rule. Hey, let's do another one, please. Y double prime. The derivative is just himself, but it will spit out a
negative
2, making that a 4c1. Are you guys all right? And this one, when I do this one, it's just himself. But the chain rule spits out another negative 1. Negative 1.
So just plus C2.
So plus C2 e to the negative x. I'm worried about your derivative skills. I mean, I just did a couple derivatives. You should have decent derivative skills. And now I want to plug them in, and it's going to work. A lot of writing when you do a problem like this. what am I doing? I'm plugging in y double prime right there. Here's y double prime. That's y double prime. Plus 3 times y prime. Okay, here's y prime. You guys all right with this? Plus 2 y's, plus 2 of the original y's, the original. Equals 0. I sure hope I did this right. I'm supposed to verify that it works. In other words, what I verify means at the end this should be true. I should get 0 equals 0. Do you see that happening? Again, a lot of writing. I can do less writing the more I do in my head, but I don't want to confuse you here. I'll do some more writing here. I'm rewriting all that. I'm distributing that. Negative 6 C1, right, you guys? Negative 3 C2. You guys okay with that? Hello? 2 C1, right. 2 C2. Okay, cool. What am I gonna do? Gather like terms together? If I gather all these e to the negative 2x's together, see them? What happens when you add all those guys up? You get a 0. I'll be darned. What happens when you add up the e to the negative x's? Here they are. The e to the negative x's. 0 of those. Okay. Hey, what does 0 plus 0 equal?
0.
Good job. All right. So 0 equals 0. We little check mark there. We verified it. You know, if you're asked to do this on a quiz or a test, or you're asked to do it in the homework, but if you're asked to do this, you know, this is, you kind of got to show me this. I mean, and the conclusion is sort of right here. I mean, you got to write all this down. You got to sort of show me that it works. Mm-hmm. At the end, you have 0 equals 0, check mark. It works, you know. So that's not as fun as solving a DE, right? Here's a DE. Here's the solution. Please prove it. It's kind of funner to solve it, to solve the DE, which we started with today, which is also in your homework. I'm looking at this 6-1 homework, and at the very beginning I see a lot of verification. Verify. I also see some, there's a lot of that verify. There's a lot of verify right at the beginning. But when I flip the page, I do get to solve some DEs. Look at I want to show you something. I'm looking at homework in 6-1. Looking at homework in 6-1, and if I flip up here, there's a nice little batch of problems, 41 through 51. I assigned them in my homework, but this is kind of how we started today. I wonder if you can do, this one, number 50. Check this out. It says that dy dx equals 2x times the square root of 4x squared plus 1. 2x times the square root of 4x squared plus 1. So what's the directions? This is a differential equation, and I'm supposed to solve it. All right, so I taught you, the only method I taught you was separate and integrate. Separate and integrate. The separate part of this problem is really easy. I did a nice advanced one. That's gone now. I did a nice separate and integrate. This is a really easy set. Well, the separate part is really easy. How do you get it separated? Multiply the dx over there, and it's separated, right? Mm-hmm. Okay, cool. So then really it's a matter of integrating. Right. By the way, all these in section 6-1 are going to be kind of easy to separate. This is how they are. They're just functions of x, and they're kind of easy. But once you separate it, now you've got dy equals this, and now your challenge is how good are you at integrating? I mean, calculus 2 is full of a lot of integration. We gotta be able to integrate. Okay. On this side, we integrate. What do we get?
Y
equals, and now I got to work on that integral. I'm gonna go over here to my little scrap paper area here. I'm working on that integral. How do I do this integral here? So it's a u substitution. It's going to be a u to the 1/2, I think. But when you do u substitution, you got to watch all the little details and to get everything perfect. But you're right. Let's do it. Here's how I do u substitution. Again, some of you knew me in Cal 1, some of you didn't. I do it like this. I let u equal 4x squared plus 1. And as soon as I declare what u is, I got to find du. And du is the derivative. And the derivative is 8x dx. So I've established a relationship between u and x. I've also established a relationship between du and dx. It falls right out of that first relationship, actually. And so now this integral can be replaced and turned into a bunch of u's, which probably can be integrated easily. Let's just see how this works. Under that radical, what's under that radical?
U.
That's a u, okay. What about this dx? What the heck is dx? All right, how do I do this? There's a few ways, y'all. Maybe you were trained. I don't know. There's a lot of different ways to think your way through this. Here's how I like to do it. Let's see. Let me go back. Let me start back up here. What about this 2? What am I going to do with the hell of this 2? I'm going to pull it out front. What am I going to do with this extra x? Well, I have an x dx. Do you see that x dx? Mm-hmm. Well, right here I have an x dx. What is x dx?
1/8 du.
It's
du
over 4.
Well, it's du over 8. Yes. Du over 8 is x dx. Hold on. So you're saying I should replace this circled stuff with?
1/8 du.
With 1/8 du. I put the 1/8 out front. Put the du right here, and this is my problem. You're right, it is a 1/4 in the end out here.
Yeah, the way KB did it is when we're still in the du step right there, and we see that we only have 2x dx,
we want
to then
8x.
Say that we have du over 4 equals 2x dx, and then we're left with the square root of u du.
Okay.
And then we integrate that.
Okay. What if it was 5s and 3s? What if it wasn't so nice? What if it came out to be a 4?
It all depends on the problem.
I know, right. Right. Yeah, right. Right. So KB might have said, kind of had a little angle on it. The truth is, it's not different. It's just there's a couple, few different ways to explain how you get from the DU back to this integral here. There's a few ways to explain that algebra move. And you can think about that algebra move two or three ways, but it's still the same algebra move. Eventually, you end up here. Now, whatever makes most sense to you, we'll try to get used to each other maybe. But that's a 1/4 in front of a u to the 1/2. Don't forget, after all that beautiful work, you haven't integrated yet. Let's integrate. How do you integrate u to the 1/2? U to the 3/2 times 2/3
yeah.
With a 1/4 out front,
right.
Plus c.
Right.
Or in the end here, that 2 cancels with that. 1/6 u to the 3/2. What's my u? 4x squared plus 1 to the 3/2 plus c. That's it. We finally integrated that. It took me a few steps. That was a good problem. And here's this is the answer to this integral here. The answer is 1/6 4x squared plus 1 to the 3/2 plus c. What do we have here? What do you call this answer here? A general solution to a differential equation. It wasn't a very complicated differential equation. And the integral wasn't that hard at all, but it was u substitution. I'm a big fan of u substitution. It happens a lot. I like u substitution. It'd be nice if you guys were really good at u substitution. All right, I think I'm going to quit, and I would suggest you start working in 6-1. If you get through there and you're bored, you might could leap up into 6-2 or 6-3 because this separate and integrate idea carries on into 6-2 and 6-3, but you don't have to do too much work before Wednesday. 6-1 would be nice. And you can, you know, when you come back to class on Wednesday, if you're working on stuff and you got questions, I mean, usually I open class with, hey, how y'all doing? Do you have some questions on the previous material? But otherwise, I just move on into some new material. But we're just at the beginning of chapter 6. It's all kind of the same material in a way. Thank you. I'll see you.